1,200 miles off the coast of New England, is one of the richest fishing grounds on Earth. The Grand Banks.
Yeah, baby.
Home to brutal weather and unpredictable seas. This is where the perfect storm exploded. Over the years, thousands of lives have been lost here. Yet every fall, a few brave fishermen risk everything as they sail these deadly waters in search of Johnny's. As the season nears its end, the Frances Ann has brought in her final load.
Thanks for bringing us home.
Yeah.
And the Seahawk steams towards home. Only two boats remain, hoping to fill their holds on one last push on the Grand Banks. Now, life is on the line as the search for souls continues. Miles off the Massachusetts coast is the little southern boat Big Eye.
We're deliberately setting this pier into a gale, try to get some of our expenses.
During the last 6 days, Captain Chompers and his crew have caught little except sharks and a brutal beating from the weather.
Now we're going to put ourselves through about 10 or 12 hours of it just deliberately. We're gonna fish further off the bank in deeper water. We're gonna set our gear deeper under the surface. And hopefully we'll be able to catch something.
They got really excited and said, okay boys, we're setting out. That's how that goes.
Chompers' abrasive style has put him at odds with his crew.
Look at me! Get the hook out of it like I told you. Take the hook out! You cannot wind these on here like. See how these are neat, Matt?
Why isn't there a ball in between the boat and the dock?
Chris, I ain't the only guy on the boat.
And his decision to set out with bad weather on the horizon isn't sitting well with the men.
You see some warm water and you all of a sudden you're just riding by and they said we're setting out. Everybody get your together. We're setting out.
If you said let's go, hey, even though you feel your heart don't want to do it, just say, hey, man, that's what I come here for. We gotta go, we gotta do it.
We'll come out here to fish for him. So we do what he tells us.
It's a gamble for Chompers. His second trip of the fall season is already a bust, and he desperately needs his luck to change. After a few hours of sleep, the crew wakes to find the weather has kicked up. They'll need to haul 30 miles of line in the muck.
Wind's humming against the wind is 35, maybe 40. They're starting to break around us. We'll go out here and run this boat wide open and see where we go.
This is our game paradise.
The Big Eye is in a tug of war with the heaving sea. The strain on the main line is too much, and it snaps.
Running for a while. This is a pretty good bar at all.
While Chompers searches for his gear in the raging storm, the crew is forced to take shelter below deck.
It sucks hauling gear like this. It really sucks.
We need a good 5,000 pounds to even make up for what we lost today. So far, it's definitely a broken trip right now.
A 1,000 miles to the northeast, the Eagle Eye 2's record trip grinds on.
This trip is basically pushing everything to the limit.
Captain Scotty has tested himself and his crew with a punishing 50 days of nonstop fishing.
It's pushing my crew and myself to the limit, physically, mentally. It's pushing the boat to the limit. Everything is like stretched out to the almost breaking point.
Hey, Darren, it's 4 o'clock.
Everybody up?
Yeah, everybody up, yeah.
It's another day that's not the last day.
Get some coffee now.
One or two more sets, man. One more tonight, one more tomorrow night. That sucks.
The cruise day starts at 5 a.m. in the gloomy darkness.
These extra days will, I think, end up paying off for us. Caught a nice, some nice fat fish yesterday. Thinking we might get a few more today.
Here we go, we got our next shot.
Once again, Scotty is on the fish. But a tangled line brings the operation to a halt.
You try bringing it right to the stern and you got himself in the runner or something. He swam in between the drop and the keel.
Got it, you got him, bud.
Yep, can't believe it. Luck, 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 luck.
One for the good guys.
Hooray. That's a sword. I said that was not. Can I say that was a sword? Everything's cold and steady. So far this morning. So far, you know, man.
Fishing's okay so far. It's going good. Everybody's happy. Nobody's complaining.
The good fishing makes it hard for Scotty to pull his gear and head back home.
I was hoping it was 4 days ago. But we're still here having so much fun. Could be one more day, could be two more days. I don't know yet. Could be today. Cross that bridge when we get to it. We got something here. We're hoping it's a swordfish. It's looking like a swordfish. By Yemeni, it is a swordfish. The elusive Xiphius gladius.
Here he comes.
What's the pop? He's gonna get him.
Looks like some pulp.
Another fine specimen rat. We got something here. Wait to it, too.
Nice shot, Bri. 1, 2, 3.
Oh, yeah!
Today's catch was respectable, with 23 swords added to their total.
Carefully sign on the end of the section. I can't say nothing.
The last sleeper right there, yeah, on board.
Get 1,000 today?
800.
800?
Yeah.
Let's add it up together, shall we?
Yeah.
75, 155, 225.
Scotty tallies the day's catch. The crew can only stand by and hope it's enough to end this marathon trip.
1280, 1320. 1,320 pounds. Small day, but a day. One more time.
For the crew of the Eagle Eye 2, the work continues.
Thought it was the last one, but it's not. It goes on.
The homesick crew may not like it, but at sea, the captain's word is the only one that matters.
Well, you must have been excited to maybe think it was all done, huh?
Too much more to say about it than that, really.
300 miles off the Newfoundland coast, the Eagle Eye 2 stretches its season to the bitter end. The exhausted crew is ready to head home, but Scotty is unwilling to leave when they still have bait and there's room on the boat for more swordfish.
We got something here. I think it's a sword.
There he comes.
With good-sized swords coming up on deck, the crew will have to wait on the captain's decision to end the season.
I don't know what's going on yet, because you know what I say, right? I got my mind on my money and my money on my mind. Could be our last day, we might set again. I gotta get the bait up, take a look at the water, play it in my mind again.
You know, we've already gone this far, what's one more set?
There we go, one set of bait left here. That's all swordfish. Looking okay down here, that's for sure.
Nearly 1,000 miles to the southwest, the Big Eye continues to take a pounding.
It's not been a treat. So far, we've lost a lot of deck tiles. We've done a lot of damage to the boat.
Captain Chompers has sent his crew below deck while he looks for gear that's been lost to the relentless sea.
Things are just not real good at all. Low pressure after low pressure after low pressure. We've seen weather like that many times, but never a spell of weather that intense for that long a time, and it just wouldn't let up on us.
But it's not just the bad weather that's been tormenting the Big Eye.
The sharks are whooping our they're destroying our gear. It's not getting too exciting to get back out there and haul it back up with a bunch of dogs on the other side.
Now the crew is stuck below deck with only a few thousand pounds of fish in the hold.
The sharks are winning and we're losing right now.
After hours of searching, Chompers finally spots the other end of his fishing line. The Big Eye is back in business.
Hi ho, hi ho. Off to work I go.
What kind of excitement we can get.
Try to keep him coming, Woody, with the tide.
Quick, lively one.
Wait, you're scared that we'll pop it off in the surge.
I ain't seen nothing but the tip.
There you go, you got him now.
Big Eye pulls in a triple marker, a fish topping 300 pounds and worth as much as $1,200. With the swells topping 12 feet, getting each fish on board is a dangerous battle.
Slightly interesting. Blew my favorite hat off my head, got some 50 mile an hour gusts. Just your average day in paradise, really. You know, you add it all up. Blowing.
Go on the deck. Go inside.
Come on, come in.
Let's have fun now.
Turn the door in. Tie the boxes in. Go inside.
Once again, the crew is forced below deck as the raging seas collapse around the Big Eye. Just a few miles off the coast, Captain Linda Greenlaw guides the Seahawk toward Fairhaven, Massachusetts.
You know what? It always feels good. It always feels good, you know, as much as I was dragging my feet about actually leaving the fishing grounds. I guess it's a good thing that the, you know, the fish left, or I'd still be there. My guys would be ready to kill me.
During their 51-day season, the Seahawk has weathered every kind of possible setback.
Cut it down!
Well, backlash!
It's the worst thing that can happen. Super dangerous.
I'm really beginning to think that there's a curse. I'm not going to do that.
It seems like everything that could go wrong did go wrong. It's just amazing.
Been long, no doubt. I've had longer, but this is, you know, been one of the longer ones, so it'll be nice to put this one to bed for sure.
Linda's veteran crew has been counting the days until they can set foot on land.
At least from here we could swim if we had to. I could make it.
We're almost there.
This trip has been a test of endurance for veteran lobster fisherman Dave Hiltz. This was his first trip to the Grand Banks. It was very nearly his last. Linda's made this run into Fairhaven more times than she can count, and every time she plays it by the book.
Whenever I get really close to, for instance, this dike up here that we have to go through, I'd much rather steer by hand. The autopilot kind of does a little more zigging and zagging than I'd be comfortable with going through a sort of narrow gap like this, so.
When you stop to think about it, you know, you're coming home, and you look at this old girl here, she did us pretty good. Everything that we've been through, she brought us home.
I see a few people I know.
Yeah.
When you get this line thrown, I'm kissing the dog.
Clears the trip from hell. I mean, you couldn't make it up. People won't believe that that much stuff can happen in one trip.
Everyone's always happy to be ashore. I know now what I missed about it, and I know exactly what I did not miss about it.
The captain got her boat and the crew in safely. All that's left is to find out what they're getting paid.
How much did that one weigh?
103. After 51 days at sea, Captain Linda Greenlaw and her crew are ready to count up their take.
The bottom line is I'm the captain of the boat. It's my responsibility to make some money for the crew, make some money for the boat owner, make some money for myself.
With only 4 days of fish in the hold since their last offload, no one is expecting a huge payday.
The second part of this trip got cut off very short because the fish disappeared. So, you know, coming from the Grand Banks with 45 fish, not the best feeling in the world.
Mike Mercado jumped ship in Newfoundland.
Yeah, it sucks. I'm ready to get out of here, you know what I mean?
But all is forgotten on dry land. Fishing the banks is a brotherhood, and back on land, the troubles at sea are forgotten and forgiven. But the Seahawks' bad luck isn't over yet.
Whoa!
50-pound fish just fell off the hook down into the fish hole.
Luckily, it didn't hit anybody, so it could have been a lot worse.
Like when he took a gaff to the hand 1,000 miles from the nearest port.
Ah! You all right?
Yeah.
Did it go through?
Yeah.
Through your whole hand?
Not through the whole hand.
123 going over the ball.
Can we just put it on that one back there?
We only made 4 sets, so there's not much age on them. So we'll keep our fingers crossed.
The final weight totals aren't overwhelming. Just 5,000 pounds. Combined with their previous trip, the crew's cut comes to just $4,000 apiece for 2 grueling months of work.
We really didn't have much, but the fish were nice, so that's something. Nice size and the quality's good.
Being a veteran captain, Linda has learned to accept the ups and downs of the Grand Bank season. Now that the offload is over, Linda has one more order before releasing the crew.
I'd like to propose a toast to my crew of the Seahawk, and I have to say I am very proud of every one of you, and I hope we can do it again next year with a better boat. Cheers, guys.
Cheers. I'd just like to say one other thing.
Yes.
I quit.
Dave, your resignation is now accepted.
Till next season.
Okay.
I have. 300 miles off the Massachusetts coast, the little Big Eye is limping home from their punishing trip to the Grand Banks.
We've been out 11 days and we've just been getting hammered the whole trip. It's just been a horrible trip. It's just something that we care not to ever go through again.
Captain Chompers has so far navigated his undersized boat through some of the worst weather of the season. And his boat has paid the price.
We didn't even know we were damaged until just now.
A monster wave bent the metal seawall and cracked the hull.
What one wave will do to you? Just one wave out of a million that we took.
With his boat falling apart around him, Chompers has no choice but to head for shore.
You're still headed to the dock, right?
Yeah, without a doubt.
Weather like that puts the Big Eye definitely on its toes. Very, very serious conditions.
The crew may not have caught much fish on this trip, but they survived.
I'm gonna go to the bar all fishy and stinky, man. It looked like that.
A 1,000 miles to the northeast, the crew of the Eagle Eye 2 are ready to head for home. But Captain Scotty may not be done fishing.
Looking down in the freezer, looks like there's 2 sets of bait left.
Is there?
Looks it. Just kidding.
You're cruel. Yep. So cruel.
You'll thank me, though.
Yeah.
Come payday.
Scotty calls the crew together.
You know, we caught a handful of fish here today. You know, but a small run and all like that. So basically what I want you to do is take all the remainder of the bait, pack the fish, but bring all that bait up and then throw it overboard, because we're out of here. We're all done.
Going home, baby, with a load of fish, yeah!
You're going home. We got a good trip again.
Oh, yeah.
La, 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 la.
Woo-hoo.
You quitting? If we had a good run of fish and a couple thousand pounds, I'd stay and chance it. But we had about a 60-pound average today, the worst we've ever done. So it's time to go.
Talk about that.
I've had fish.
You got it.
Before steaming home, the crew must make sure they protect their precious cargo.
Well, right now, we pack in the fish we caught today. We have like about a 7-day steam back to the States, so we gotta make sure the fish is packed real tight.
See you later.
Scotty throws his glove into the sea to signify the end of the trip.
We're out of here.
Bye-bye.
That's it. I'm happy.
And the crew make sure to get the bait off the boat before Scotty can change his mind.
They said take off the rest of the bait that's down there and fire it over the side. It was the nicest thing I heard in 28, 29 days, I'll tell you that.
See ya.
With the hard work done, the crew's thoughts turn to how many thousands of pounds of fish they've caught.
Now the betting begins. How much is on the boat?
Who wants that bet with me now? Anybody wants to bet with me?
I'll bet you.
I'm gonna say we have at least 57.
But I say 58.
Yeah.
Don't forget. I'll say 57.5.
54.
54?
Okay, 55.
Got a good trip on.
Thank you guys for hanging in there.
Appreciate it.
No problem.
After 60 days at sea, Scotty can finally set a course for home.
Being a captain, I always want more fish. You know, I would have loved more fish, but reality of what's going on, we did real good. We did real good.
From port in Fairhaven, Massachusetts, Captain Scotty of the Eagle Eye 2 is in a precarious spot.
You can't see anything here right now. And we've got a fair tide, which means it's pushing us along. The boat's very unstable, hard to control.
The Eagle Eye is crossing the Cape Cod Canal into Buzzards Bay.
It's a pain in the ass trying to drive this boat through the canal. Got to really pay attention here.
The contrast in temperature from sea to land has formed a thick fog.
The main danger right here is zero visibility. You can't see other traffic coming at you. We could just barely see the sides of the canal, and the canal's only a couple hundred yards wide. So it's tricky, to say the least. This is ridiculous. That's what it is. Man, I can't see. I can barely see the bow. If we get outside this channel, we go right aground. It's 2 feet, 5 feet, 3 feet. The Eagle Eye 2 is drawing about 14 feet right now, so we go outside this channel, there's gonna be an abrupt stop.
Like a pilot flying blind, Scotty leans on his radar to maintain course.
We have exited the canal and Hog Island Channel, so now we're in Buzzards Bay.
Once they clear the canal, the fog lifts. Scotty can now focus on his calculator instead of the radar.
Trying to figure out what we stocked, what our gross is, what expenses are, and what you crew members might be looking at here. And this is what I'm coming up with for a rough number.
For who?
You.
Ha! That's what I like to see. If I got that, I would know that. Oh my goodness.
That's a fair estimate on what the cruise share should be for this trip.
So for each guy, they're gonna
get? For each guy, it looks like around just over $25,000.
But Scotty has one final duty as captain before this trip is over. Parking the boat.
I don't know if there's really enough room for us to get in there or not. I wouldn't be surprised if we bang somebody here. We're not gonna fit. This is gonna be a real tight fit, so stand by with a ball, because I'm gonna have to hug the Liberty.
Scotty's concerns are justified. He slides his boat into its berth with inches to spare.
Man, there's not much room in between here and there. Here we go. We're done. Trip's over. Oh my God, thank God. Yes, sir. Beautiful.
Fairhaven, Massachusetts. Captain Scotty is offloading the Eagle Eye 2 for the final time this season.
It was definitely my longest trip I've ever been on. And looking at the fish hold, it's definitely looking like my best trip. I'm looking forward to the total. I'm looking forward to what the price is going to be.
By being the last in, Scotty hopes to get the best possible price for his fish.
I heard rumors around $550, so if that's the case, we're looking at about $300,000 stock.
More money for him, more money for his crew.
See, he's got the good response.
We're getting ready to pack the fish out.
First fish on the scale, 102.
By mid-morning, the Eagle Eye 2 had already offloaded 20,000 pounds, and they haven't even hit the halfway mark.
What I smell down there is I smell money.
Go.
Slow, Jim.
Four bags. Okay. Oh, that's it.
Probably over $300,000 worth, so.
Money.
Yeah, we might be making more than we expected. We might be making like about $25,000 or maybe more.
207. I like this scale.
Up, slap!
A monster. Diamonds, you call that. Diamonds.
Well, there goes our last fish right there. We're all done, final. 2008 Grand Bank season finished.
4.6 miles to the east in New Bedford, the mood is much more somber. The crew of the Big Eye is about to get paid.
Thank you, honey. I'm not happy. Of course, if I'm not happy, the crew's not going to be happy. We've got our numbers back, and it's a horrifying sight.
2 months of risking their lives on the Grand Banks have come to this.
Our paychecks were like $800-some, and the crew weren't really happy with that.
I'm 62. Why should I work if you don't get paid?
What really pisses you off, we're out there busting our putting our life on the line. It seems like we always get the low end of the deal every time.
Chompers claims the 50,000 pounds of fish offloaded this season barely covered his expenses.
It's really hard to believe, but we have it all on paper, and the truth is the truth, and our numbers are just really, really bad.
I have to borrow money to pay the crew because
they can't not get a check.
It will be hard for Choppers to convince any of his crew to go back out with him.
If you don't pay me, I say, hey man, good luck. I'm gonna leave.
Crewman John Weeks does leave the Big Eye for a job as fishing captain of the Seahawk. Chompers is already planning another trip.
We're gonna lick our wounds and head back out and do it again. We're not quitters. We won't quit until somebody comes takes that boat from me.
After nearly 60 days at sea, the Swordfish fleet is safely in port.
I'll raise a toast. Chompers, very bold move coming to the Grand Banks with that boat. Way to go.
We're dealing with 30 knots of wind today, and look at us.
Weather's deteriorating rather quickly. Seems like more water's going over top of us than underneath us.
What you needed to do? Good going.
Yeah, thank you. Got the job done, man.
Thank you.
Good for you.
The way I feel about coming out to the Grand Banks and making the big roll the dice with the Big Eye, Chompers is making a gamble going to the Grand Banks. That's the last thing I want to do is fail.
We need to at least get 1,000 pounds a day to keep us from business.
I'm not a failure. I don't like to fail. I'm there, and I'm going to give it my 100% shot. I was always taught, put the fish in the hole.
The money goes in the pocket.
Yeah, but it's like I've never caught that many fish and not made any money. I just don't understand it.
Yeah.
I mean, we had, what, 20 doubles? 8 triples, a 4-banger, and 3 fish that were over 500 pounds. Big Eye is not the Eagle Eye. Big Eye is not the Seahawk. I know my limitations, and I know, and I'm always gambling with it. And I know that I could have come ahead, but we have to have the right price to do it.
Yeah.
I'll raise a toast.
Okay.
Congratulations on a huge trip, Scott. I understand it could be a record breaker. Way to go.
Thank you.
You deserve it.
Appreciate
Cheers.
It.
At the start of the season, Linda and Scotty made a friendly wager.
I am here to square up a bet. Here comes a big one. That's a size large.
What's your biggest fish?
My biggest fish is 438 pounds.
My biggest fish, 442.
Ouch. Okay, no, I remember this bet being for $100.
Oh.
There you go, man.
I'm ready next year.
So Scott, let's hear about this big bluefin episode.
It was an over a 3-hour battle.
We got a fish here.
Might be a bluefin. When I was hauling, I came up on him, and he was belly up. He came right up to the surface, rolled on his belly, and I just could not bring him up. It came hour two, and I was like, he's got to be wearing out. So let him go. And then the third hour, we got him up enough, and of course, he was in a snarl. And then I was like, get the harpoon ready.
Let me see that harpoon.
He made a circle out, going down underneath the boat. He's about 8-9 feet down, so I just hit him, bang.
Got him.
And all of a sudden, as soon as I hit him, he just stalled out. We got him up, and then we hooked him up.
That was great out, really nice.
He did, number one fat.
Number one fat.
When I left 10 years ago, there were always 30 or 40 boats on that main break, man. East
That's
side
right.
of the Grand Banks, 30 or 40 boats. We never had more than 4 fishing one night.
Yeah.
When I was 19 years old, you land a triple swordfish. If you're lucky, you average $4 a pound. Here I am, 47 years old. If you're lucky, you average $4 a pound.
That's
what the hell?
Right.
Oh, come on.
Everything.
That is just not right.
You got a better chance to win in the lottery than average $4.
Exactly.
I can guarantee you that.
I mean, what's wrong with that picture? This is the last toast of the night. Mm-hmm. And I want to say that I am really honored to be with both of you guys tonight. I am with the new guy, the future of the fishery, right here. Mm-hmm. And I am with the Highliner, mm-hmm. right here. So, cheers to you guys.
Here we go.
I couldn't be prouder to be with both right now.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Cheers. Thank you.
For Scotty and Chompers, the end of the Grand Banks season marks the start of a new season. Currently, they're prowling the Bermuda coast in search of big tuna. Linda returned home to her lobster fishery, but her experience on the Grand Banks has reignited her desire to bring in the big fish. And when the storms of winter pass and the swords return to this productive fishing grounds, this brave bunch of gamblers will once again risk it all to bring in Grand Banks gold.
It's original.